Sound check.
Hello, hello.
Oh, hello, yes. Hello, here we are in Sedona. My voice sounds even better in Sedona than it normally does.
Absolutely, it's magic.
Better air, isn't it?
Everything.
Better air, better water.
So hi everyone out there in the webiverse. I'm Tanya June Moore. This is Sedona International Film Festival 2016. And I have the distinct pleasure of being here with Tara Knotts. And I think people will know you as being Don Knotts' daughter.
Yes, they do. I'm very thrilled to be here and to do my show, Tied Up in Knots.
Yes.
Which is about growing up with my father.
Yes.
Who was an amazing person as well as a legendary comedian.
Yeah, and we love to hear that. We love to hear that they live up to what our perceptions of them are. So
yes.
Talk a little bit about him as a dad.
Well, he was just an unpredictable father. He was funny, but he was also serious, and he had his own sense of humor. You know, people think of him as Barney Fife, you know, and the whole, and they ask me, you know, you don't look anything like your father, and then I say, what about now? But see what I mean?
Yeah.
Convinces people. But he wasn't really like Barney most of the time, although sometimes he could get a little Barney Fife-ish, like if he got excited about something. And I do talk about all that in my show. But he just had this ironic sense of humor, you know, that was just all his own. And I remember just going out and eating with him at the restaurant, and I could see people, as soon as they spotted him, you know, they'd be all chatting, there he is, there's Don Knotts. And then I'd see them make the decision to come over, and they'd be so timid, they'd be like tiptoeing over, oh, should we bother him? And they'd say hello, and he would just be so delightful to people. He'd say, oh, hello, how are you? Just this down-home guy, you know.
Yeah. And when I was growing up, I mean, I loved all the Tim Conway, Don Knotts films. Were you on set with those ever? Those were before you were 10.
Oh, no, I'm 61. I have memory of everything. I was on the set for the Andy Griffith Show.
Mm.
I'm the same age as Ron Howard.
Okay.
So I remember him. I remember coming on the set. And everybody was bigger than life, you know. But then again, they were just real people.
Right.
Too, so... but I remember Ronnie Howard, he always had these little gadgets. He had a little, like, tiny little transistor radio. And in that time, there was no such thing as a radio that small. And he had one, and it was gold. And I was like, wow, I was looking at it. It was like the Wizard of Oz, you know.
Yeah.
But he was my own age, and I'm like, this guy isn't like a regular kid, you know. He was nice, and he was courteous and everything, but he was just beyond his years.
Yeah.
And Andy Griffith was just an absolute adorable man to me and my dad. And Andy Griffith was just this, when I say bigger than life, he's the one I was referring to. He just had this youth and personality to just knock you out of your chair. When he started laughing, he was like the world. And he took care of people. He would just go out of his way to... I mean, everybody on that set felt listened to. Everybody in that show felt they were important. He wanted input from everybody. Although they didn't have, it wasn't like today where the sitcoms have all this high class, you know,
equipment
or whatever you want. There's your, you know, they had little small dressing rooms. In fact, there's a Peeping Tom story. There was a Peeping Tom on the set. And guess who the Peeping Tom was peeping on? Aunt B.
What?
Mm.
Aunt B had a peeping Tom. And the story is amazing because they were on the lookout for this peeping Tom. And so one day somebody yelled out, the peeping Tom, peeping Tom. And the security guard was so nervous, he got out his gun and he just fired it into the air. And he was so overcome with, he was so upset that he'd fired his own gun that he collapsed. And so everybody ran to help the security guard, and the peeping Tom got away. And then we found out later he was in a wheelchair, and that's why nobody knew who he
nobody
was. He just got in a wheelchair and turned around and rolled out the door. So
interesting.
So even Mayberry has its little, you know,
little quirk.
It's little quirky.
Well, and it's such an iconic show.
Yes.
And I mean, of course, your father played iconic roles in everything.
He did. He always created something so special.
Yes.
And like when he did Mr. Furley on Three's Company,
yes.
You know, the landlord. They didn't know, I tell a little bit more about this in my show, but Norman Fell was the original landlord on Three's Company, and he left to do a spinoff. And the producers were all like, oh, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? We can't replace Norman Fell. He's such an original character. And then somebody said, hey, you know what? Why don't we get a Don Knotts type? And the casting director said, what do you mean a Don Knotts type? Why don't you just get Don Knotts?
Yes.
Of course. And they were like, oh, is he still alive? Yes, of course he's still alive. He's probably available and just waiting for you to call him, you know, so... Of course, he was actually right there. It was a little thing they had planned, you know, so he got the part.
Yes.
But he just created it and made his own.
Yes. Well, and he's one of those, I love character actors because without them, like, things aren't as special, shows aren't as special, movies aren't as special. And with him, I mean, for me growing up, I mean, I'm sure for you, every character he created was uniquely his own.
That's right.
And I hope you go into that in the show.
I do. I talk about how he created Barney Fife, how he rehearsed Barney Fife, which was amazing because it was, he rehearsed so much, but you know, he made it look, you know, the character looked so real and so like that person really exists.
Yes.
Even today, people kind of believe in Barney Fife like he's a real person.
Yes.
You know, but I was there to hear how he created and made that character seem so real and natural.
Did he base his characters on real-life people that he had met, or were they all out of his imagination?
I think they were him, you know, they were him. My dad used to say a lot of times that Barney Fife is like a child. And he used to say that all the time in interviews. And when I thought about it, I realized that Barney Fife was probably him as a child. Because he had all those same emotions. He grew up in kind of a tough neighborhood, and they were poor, Depression era poor. And he had, his defense was his humor, making fun of himself. And then he had these older brothers who picked on him and kind of teased him, and they were just being funny. You know, and in those days, in the 30s, humor was kind of different. It was, I mean, I know from talking to him, humor had a kind of a different feel. It was more gentle and more ironic and more intelligent in a way. And in other ways, it was more teasing and poking fun and, you know, and putting you on the defensive. So there was this kind of dichotomy of humor there, and he grew up with both of that, all of that. And all kind of informed, I think, his humor, his characters. Mm-hmm. And he did have a lot of, you know, that teasing when he was growing up.
Yeah. So what was a day in the life of you, Don Knotts, as your father? Just a typical...
A typical day. Well, it's hard to say because I grew up, you know, with him in different phases. And I was a child. I had my mother there and everything. And we were a nuclear family. And my dad was working a lot, so I didn't see him a whole lot. But then my parents divorced, and I went to live with my father. So he was single for that time, and I was going to high school. And so my mother was living on a ranch up in Northern California, so my dad was my whole parenting thing at the time. And so, but he was also sort of dysfunctional, like he would ask my advice for things. So, yeah, he didn't like being alone very much, and he was a single father, but he was always very popular with women. Women loved my dad. He always said women in love with him, but he didn't really know how to, I mean, just like anybody, how do you find that right relationship right now? So he stayed in relationships that weren't right for him sometimes. If he didn't, wasn't in a relationship, he would be very upset and unhappy, you know, and he would go into these sort of ruminations about things. I called it the endless loop, like, oh, he would be talking about something, and this is in the past. But he would, like, he couldn't break out of this negativity that he was in. And so he would just keep ruminating, and I would be, he would keep me up. This is like way past my bedtime. I would be up like 1 o'clock in the morning. And I would try to get him to break out of that loop. And then, you know, once in a while I could, you know, but mostly I couldn't. And he finally got a really great psychiatrist who helped him. But then come morning time, I couldn't get up. I was asleep. I couldn't, you know, finally, and I would get up. And we lived at the top. We lived on Will Rogers Drive. Will Rogers had a home, and it's now a museum there. And I would run down this long, because I'd miss the school bus. I'd run down this long, windy canyon. And the housekeeper would write me a note, usually saying that I had some kind of a problem. Kept me from, because I was in high school. Sometimes, once in a while, I would get a ride to school. Some of the housekeepers drove, some of them didn't. You know, we had different ones. But was very close to my father, you know, for all these reasons. Now, I don't go into all this in my show because it would take too long. You know, I have an hour and 25 minute time focus. So I have different versions, and I do stand-up comedy, and I'm writing a book and all that. But the show, it's kind of more of an action-oriented thing, you know. But I do talk a lot about this going to the set and the characters and the people and all that.
Well, now I have all kinds of questions. Favorite memory?
Oh, gosh, there's so many of them. Well, I love going on sets. My dad did this, I think my favorite movie of my father's is the one a lot of people haven't even heard of. It's called The Love God. So you hadn't heard of it?
I haven't.
No, you haven't.
Oh, yes.
Have you heard of it?
Seen it,
okay. Well, The Love God was a parody of Hugh Hefner. My dad played publisher Birdman. And these guys have published a girly magazine. They're in trouble, so they're trying to find a frontman for the girly magazine. And they get Abner Peacock, is his name. And so a little before Abner Peacock realizes that he's becoming a sex symbol for this magazine, and he doesn't realize what's going on. And this was at the height of the 60s, you know, with all the fashions and all of the, you know, the great Nehru jackets and the capes and he had all these costumes.
Love it.
Incredible outfits, and there were, you know, gorgeous women on set that were, you know, paid to follow Abner Peacock around wherever he went and stuff. And I think that was my favorite time, was being on set for that and getting to see all those people. Wonderful Anne Francis, one of my favorite actresses, she played opposite him in that film. Just incredible performance on her part, too. And my dad was just great. And I remember, as far as memories go, my dad had the scene where he had to be doing bird calls. And he had a record. It was like an old 78 record with bird calls on the record. And he just played over and over. And he would make his lips go with the bird calls. Like, hear the bird call and see him trying all these faces and things. It was just hilarious.
A lot of rehearsal.
A lot of rehearsing. He rehearsed quite a bit. He said the only person who rehearsed more than he did was Lucille Ball. She was even more adamant about rehearsing than he was. So.
Yeah. People don't realize that comedy is really, it's timing. And
yes, it is.
And speaking of comedians, you yourself are a comedian in your own right, and
yes,
you're very successful at that.
Well, I'm getting there. You know,
you can buy it naturally. And that's what, you know. Do you feel like it's a natural, like some people just have natural comic timing? Do you feel
like
you inherited that and you got that from?
I do, and also from, you know, osmosis, watching him, being around him, and his natural funniness, watching him rehearse, and then I have my own humor, which I do, and, you know. When I do my stand-up comedy, my humor is different. It's my own unique humor. This show, I do my own humor in coordination with doing his. You know, it's sort of like both. Because it's like my silly attitude mixed with talking about him, which is very real and honest, you know. So it's been a lot of fun. It's been quite a journey. You know, I started doing the show, and well, right before he passed away, because I said, you know, Dad, I want to work on this, and you know, he was giving me some ideas. But then he got sick faster than anybody expected, and he passed away. So I immediately launched into really working on the show. And because I realized, and this is funny, that maybe you have similar experience when you're a child. Your parents talk about different things when you're a child. You know, they talk about things they remember as children.
Yes.
And as you grow older, you don't hear the stories as much anymore. And I realized that I hadn't heard those stories, and I'd better start writing them down.
Yes.
And so I did, and I started really working on all of that. And then I started doing it. The first time I did the show, I thought it was just awful. And people said, hey, that was great. And I was like, what do they know? They're just an audience. But I thought, okay, well, I'll keep on working on this. You know? So, and then gradually, now it's actually gotten to the point where I even like my show, so I'm happy with it, and I'm just very pleased with that. I'm just so grateful that I've continued to have opportunities to do this show in different places.
Well, and to keep him alive, too.
Yes, and to fill up the connection with him.
Yes.
You know, that's really important.
And talk about your book a little bit. I know I've read you're putting a book out. Mm-hmm. So can we know a little bit about that and what it's about?
Well, I'm still writing the book. It's not anywhere near being finished right now. But it's right now I'm interviewing a lot of people that I can, you know, unfortunately a lot of people who knew him. But there's still a lot of people around who remember him. And just even people who never met him just have incredible stories about their feelings about him or where they were when they... how he affected their lives. And then people who did know him have some surprising things to say. So I've got to figure out, how do I translate these interviews and these things into my book and my story? So it's I haven't quite figured that out. I'm in the process of that, but it's all a lot of my own stories and their stories. And then I'm going to just weave that all in together.
Great.
Yeah.
To me, and everybody I grew up with, he felt like part of our family.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, anybody who watched Andy Griffith,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it was on before I was even born, we watched it
mm-hmm.
all the time. When I see him now watching, it takes me back to my own childhood.
Right.
Does that do the same for you? Like, when you watch his old movies, or are you seeing him with Tim Conway doing does it take you back and make those were good days? Or
not really. I just really lock in the characters and the work he's doing.
Mm-hmm.
But I do respect that, and so my show incorporates a lot of the things from the eras. You know, I talk about products or different things that were going on at the time, that because I know people have that frame of reference.
Correct.
And they are going back to that time period, so I honor that time period in the show, and it's very much a nostalgia show, not just because of my dad's work, but because of all of that everybody was living through.
Yes. Was it, going to school, you know, being Don Knotts' daughter, was it difficult?
It was in some ways, and even Ron Howard had a difficult time with his fame, but, when I went to Beverly Hills High, I had a hard time. Because everybody was related to somebody famous, and Don Knotts wasn't necessarily cool.
Oh.
You know, at that school, you know, it wasn't. So you were competing with all of these stars' kids. And I was not very confident of myself in any way. You know? And that was a tough period for me. And my father afterwards, he said, you know what? I'm so sorry I didn't take you out of that school. Put you into another school. It didn't occur to him. He knew I was struggling. And I felt bad that he even felt
bad about it.
But, you know, I think I would have had trouble any school because I was just going through that time.
It's a tough time.
It's a tough time for me. Some people, I guess some people miraculously get through it okay, but I think, you know, a lot of people go through that stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I agree. It sounds like you just had such a great relationship with him.
And
I can't wait to see the show.
Thank you.
I do want to open it up for the gallery to ask some questions.
Oh, yes.
Please.
Yeah, hi, Karen.
Hi.
Yeah, we're going to see the show tonight. I can't wait.
Fantastic.
Big Don Knotts fan. Always watched, the Andy Griffith show. And you said you're writing a book and interview some of the people that are still around. How about Ron Howard? Any recent communications with him?
Yes,
any recent communications with Ron Howard?
I did interview Ron, and I'm gonna. He said that I can interview him again when I get closer to finishing. Ron Toll has helped me, but the trouble is, you know, people when they try to remember back to that period, the memories, they only remember certain things, and so they, you know, it's hard for them to remember details of things.
And he was rather young, what, 8 maybe, or?
He started much younger than that.
Yeah.
He was like 5 or 6.
Phenomenal actor, I'll tell you that.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, he did tell me a few things, but I have some other sources, too, for that period.
Yeah. Who, any other notable people you've interviewed related to the show that are still around?
Well, let's see. I'm still working. I've interviewed Betty Lynn, and I'm going to talk to Maggie Peterson, who played Charlene.
Yeah.
And I've talked to a number of people like that, and so there will be a lot more.
You're regularly doing sets at the comedy store. Are there any like up and coming comedians that you're really excited about that you've worked with? How do you feel comedy has like evolved since you started working to now? Like you were talking a little bit about how, you know, when your father was starting, comedy was a little bit more ironic, a little bit more teasing. How do you think? How would you compare that to like the Louis C.K.'s and the Amy Schumer's of today?
What a great question! Thank you for asking that.
I can't even repeat that. Comedians today.
That is a wonderful question because I can tell you very directly about how my father discouraged me from doing stand-up comedy because, and I figured this out, in his day, there was one woman doing stand-up comedy. You know who that was? Phyllis Diller. And, you know, so he was afraid I was going to turn into this, you know, wild-haired, you know, cigar smoking, you know, he pictured me that way. And he's like, no, honey. And then plus the stand-up comedy scene was evolving with Robin Williams, and it was just, you know, all the improv thing. And he didn't see me doing that. He didn't see me doing that. And then he said, well, there's this wonderful new comedian on the scene, Eddie Izzard. He was all excited about Eddie Izzard. Well, Eddie Izzard single-handedly changed the face of stand-up comedy with his characters that he did and his improv style. And because of Eddie Izzard, I was able to find a place in stand-up comedy myself. Because that's the kind of comedy I do, too, where you kind of talk back and forth, you know, and it's not the, you know, when he was young, it was like, set up joke, and all the very much the Henny Youngman, you know, style. Now it's completely gone and completely other way. And that old comedy still does exist, too. But now there are all these other forms of comedy. And I wish that you could see me doing it now. I have a show coming up in Los Angeles. I might as well mention in case anybody's in Los Angeles. At the Canyon Club, Craig Shoemaker is the headliner, and he does a wonderful Barney Fife routine. And he's having me on his show. That's this coming Wednesday night. The 24th.
2 days tomorrow.
Tomorrow night. Yes.
How's that?
Canyon Club in Agoura Hills. Yes. So I'll be performing there at 9. Let's see. You'll just go on the website, the Canyon Club with Craig Shoemaker. Okay, thank you.
Question.
All right. Most of your father's films were family-oriented films. Did he do that on purpose, that he only wanted to do those? Because it just seemed like, I mean, it was something you could take everyone to, from the little kids to grandmother, you know, the Apple Dumpling Gang and the Ghost of Mr. Chicken, and, you know, going back to those kind of. And they were all great movies, and I think most of them have lasted long because they were a family.
That's another great question. I'm glad you asked that, because then
choose to do family movies.
Right. That wasn't his choice, per se. That was the way he was seen, because Barney Fife locked that into people's minds. You know, he was that very clean-cut character. But it did end up frustrating him a little bit, because he, you know, when the 60s came, that whole clean family humor kind of went out. And so while he had these five-picture deal with Universal Studios, by the time that contract was over, those clean family pictures were not being made anymore. So he had to find another thing. But the reason why the love god was, it was buried, because it was not that clean, wholesome thing. And the studio didn't realize what they were doing, because they had this five-picture deal and they had their own little company. And all of a sudden they went in and they saw, oh my gosh, this is Don Knotts doing something kind of sexy. And they buried it. They did not advertise it. They didn't really do anything to promote it. So that's why a lot of people never knew about it. And then, you know, my dad was a little frustrated. He never minded being typecast. He never minded playing that character. But it did kind of bother him that he was so restricted on that. Not that he was going to do anything dirty or anything, but, times were getting a little bit more looser about things being, clean or dirty. There was a little bit more play in there,
Right.
And so he kind of got even with the network one time. He had a special called The Nice, Clean, Decent, Wholesome Hour. Don Knotts, Nice, Clean, Decent, Wholesome Hour, in which he made fun of the networks making him so, so clean and squeaky clean. And it was really the most brilliant, I think, one of the most brilliant variety shows I ever saw. And I think it was written by Bill Dana, and unfortunately, in those days, they destroyed everything. Because they didn't know that there was going to be this whole Second Life, that there was going to be DVDs, and they had vaults and vaults filled with old material, and they just burned it. So that is gone. That is just gone. So, unfortunately, I know.
Yes.
So, have you noticed that there is a different measurement or a different expectation because of your lineage with you becoming a comedian?
Is there a different expectation for you?
Well,
or a different bar set,
I don't think there's any expectation. Most people don't even know I exist, actually. And I do these shows on the road, and I do them in small towns. This is quite glamorous for me. I don't usually do big cities or anything like that. But when I do my stand-up comedy, it's challenging because you have an audience of people of all different ages. And, people my age are very familiar with Dean Griffith's show. People in their 30s and 40s are more familiar with Three's Company. People in their 20s, many of them have never heard of Don Knotts. I know, it's shocking. And then kids, so I immediately, the first thing I have to do is figure out who have I got in my audience? What's their frame of reference? And they don't really have any preconceived notion of me, particularly. And then, when I say that I'm Don Knotts' daughter, I think there's a sort of misbelief, like, what? You're kidding, right? Or something like that.
Yeah.
And then I do the face thing, and then they go, okay. When I was growing up, though, then, yes, I did feel a pressure. I did feel like, well, you're Barney Fife's daughter. And then I was immediately expected to be able to rattle off, how many pickles were in Aunt Bee's pickle jars? all those trivia questions they were throwing at me. And I've never been good in those trivia things. I'm not a trivia person.